2018 GSL Season 2 Overgrowth. 2018 GSL Season 2 Codas Overgrowth.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another day here. The GSL Codas are now in the round of 8. And there's crazy matches we have coming up here. We've already eliminated so many great players. But with this being, I would say, actually the best season of GSL that we've ever had.
Yeah.
Some of these guys, like world champions going out in the round of 16. Crazy stuff has been going down.
Yeah, there's definitely been a few upsets, like Ro getting second place in his group, which gets him to play Maru tonight. Of course, the match that everyone's waiting for.
Right.
ByuN is back. He's on fire. He's looking like he did in championship form, or maybe even better. This is like a very crazy season right now, and tonight's going to be amazing. We're going to go ahead and show that bracket just to double, triple underline this. Look at that. Rogue versus Maru tonight, as well as Classic versus ByuN. Don't count ByuN out here. He destroyed stats. He's like playing some of the best PvP we have ever seen from anybody. So he goes up against the PvT monster tonight. Of course, on Saturday, we're going to have Zest versus Deer, a couple of the older Protosses, both in good form, I guess, at the moment. Even though Deer has looked bumpy, he's won his group, so good on him.
Right.
Doesn't matter how you look. It just matters if you win. TY Gumiho, man.
Yeah, on Saturday, we got two excellent mirror matchups. Really tough to call who's going to win that, to be honest. The fact that Deer has torn through everybody is crazy. Zest is looking really better than he's looked in a long time. I think a lot of people would say TY is supposed to beat Gumiho, but the fact that Gumiho upset his group so hard.
Yeah, he was looking good too, wasn't he?
Everybody is right now reasserting themselves. You have ByuN, for instance, here today. He had a bumpy set of games in the Super Tournament, which we casted just recently.
Yeah.
And we're seeing a completely different iteration of him. Rogue, obviously, I think he's looking better than anybody's looked in a long time, but you can never count someone like Maru out in a situation like that. Overall, this group is just so exciting. Classic as well. This guy is completely revamped.
He took down his Dark.
Yeah,
he beat Dark. I mean, that tells you so much. It's a crazy day. Both these matches can go either way. Everyone has been asking me all day long, who wins Maru or Rogue? It's obviously Rogue, but it's going to be a good match. Maru right now, the hottest player in the short term, but for the last year, it's been Rogue.
Yeah, well, Rogue is the only thing he hasn't accomplished as of late was actually winning our last GSL Code S.
Pretty much.
Instead of us just naming all the other tournaments that he's been to, we'll just put it like that. But you're right, Maru most recently is the hottest player that we have.
And he won that last Code S. So, these guys on their same team, too.
Ooh. Coming into this series, I think it will, no matter what, be going into Game 5.
Yeah,
I don't imagine
right.
We're going to have a 3-0 here. That
I don't
maybe,
think it could be a
3-0.
That doesn't even make
so.
Sense. Like,
well, I feel like these guys are both so good, I can't imagine many games ending right away.
If there's a 3-0, it's because Rogue 3-0'd, by the way. Because it would be something like he wins Game 1, then he scouts the barracks that are near his base in Game 2. And then maybe it gets out of control. But, yeah, it feels like at least a 3-1, probably a 3-2. It's going to be a sick match, no doubt. It's literally the best Terran in the world versus best Zerg in the world. The two hottest players in the world. I mean, they're both on Jhin'Air Green Wings. Whoever wins this, I think you have to mark down as, like, the favorite of the tournament, right?
I believe so. Again, though, there's been so many upsets already here in the GSL. Let's put it like this. Expect the winner of this to go on to the finals and possibly take it. But don't be too surprised if somebody does usurp that position and move in their
place. Crazy upsets have been happening all over the world, man. Who knows? As far as I can tell, maybe Mana gets to the finals of this tournament as well.
Yeah, that was another crazy one.
Yeah.
Watching what went down in Austin. Look, this is going to be a lot of fun. I love it when we do get to the round of 8 section of a GSL. The group phases are always fun, but when we get to the point where players are actually beginning to have a lot of time to just prep for one opponent, there's a lot of games that they're going to have to look into. So it's not just unpacking the matchup and the maps, but really diving deep psychologically into how your opponent plays, what his or her strengths or weaknesses are going to be. And the fact that, you know, when in a best of five like this, you have enough time to get a better read on your opponent, right?
Oh, yeah. We're going to dive into that even deeper in a minute here.
Physically, 너무 좋고 딱 봐도 재능이 너무 뛰어난 아이라고 생각하고 있어요.
단점?
단점은 연습을 너무 안 해요. 근데 제가 또 열심히 하면 성재 옆에서 또 열심히 할 것 같아가지고 저도 시험 하려고요.
화를 많이 내. 게임 지고 멘탈이 많이 나가. 그 얘기를 제일 많이 하는 거예요. 자기가 더 잘했는데 왜 지는지 모르겠어요.
제가 게임 지면은 이게 화가 너무 많이 나가지고 참을 수가 없더라고요.
형들한테 착하다. 형들한테도 잘 하는 것 같아요.
형주 되게 착하고 정이 많은 것 같아요. 형주가 뭐 자기 관리를 좀 안 하는 것 같아요. 게임만 해요, 하루 종일. 누워있고 게임하고. 그래서 형주야 운동도 좀 하고 자기 관리를 좀 같이 하자.
욕을 많이 해. 게임 치면.
그럼 입으로 욕을 해? 키보드로?
둘 다예요. 상상 이상이라서.
제가 또 옆에서 많이 배운 게 있어가지고 지금까지 수수생을 하면서 많이 배워가지고 형주야 꼭 1등으로 올라가고 싶은데 너무 미안하고 재밌는 경기 했으면 좋겠다.
형은 정말 만나기 싫었는데 이렇게 만나게 됐으니까 재밌게 하자.
그래도 그 약간 멤버를 빼주셨겠다.
그러면 열심히 할 것 같아서.
그래요?
네, 그날 열심히 할 것 같아요. 집중해가지고 할 것 같아서.
Funny. Don't forget, these two, of course, are teammates. They've lived together a long time. Makes the match all that much more interesting.
That's right. We're going to be going into the interview with these two players, find out what their thoughts are in the moments before this round of eight match. Hello, Maru. Hello, Rogue. Hello, hello.
먼저 조성주 선수, 이병렬 선수만 아니면 2연속 우승도 가능하다 했는데 정말 딱 올라왔습니다.
So you said as long as you weren't facing Rogue, you could probably make it to the finals of these, but here you are facing him now. How do you feel?
대신을 해서 너무 마음이 아프고요.
네.
만나서.
Yeah, he said he'd make it out of the group first as well. And he didn't.
자, 이병렬 선수,
so he's betrayed me. Here we are now. I'm very uncomfortable with this.
올라오고 있습니다. 김대엽 선수도 있었고 신영 선수도 있었는데요. 이 조성주
You've been defeating many recent champions on your way to the round of eight, such as Stats and Innovation. How do you feel about facing Maru?
그냥 저도 마음 편하게 있으려고 했는데
First of all, I think Maru is my adorable teammate.
형주를 정말 만나기 싫었는데
I don't feel great about facing him. I'm a little bit nervous. So, in the round of 16, I was pretty disappointed in myself. I thought I should easily get out first. But I guess this is an unavoidable situation, so here we are now.
풀지 못한 숙제가 있습니다. 팔병렬 아직 안 깨지고 있어요. 이 팔병렬 자신에게 어느 정도 의식이 되는 문제이신지
So you haven't quite broken that GSL round of 8 curse. You've lost several times in the past before. Do you feel any pressure? He says yes. I haven't made it to the semifinals in the GSL. So whenever I go to the quarterfinal matches, I always
I
don't know if I can bring my 100%.
GSL 8강의 벽인데 자 조성주 선수 이 사성주를 깨면서 우승도 하셨던 거잖아요.
네.
그 사성주 깨는 게 정말 어렵지 않으셨어요?
거의 8년 걸렸으니까 네.
네. So, Maru, you've broken your semifinals curse. He said, yeah, it took only 8 years to break that.
얼마나 힘든 건지 좀 조언을 해준다면.
일단 이번 시즌은
Can you give any advice on to Rogue and how to break that curse?
다음 시즌에 들었으면 좋겠어요.
네.
I don't think he's going to have a chance to break that curse this season. So, let's focus on next season, Rogue.
이렇게 훈훈하게 서로에게 한마디를 하면서 시작을 해 볼까 하는데요.
Before we have our matches, any words you want to say to each other?
일단은
And you first wrote?
저는 저도 상관없고 이겨도 상관없어가지고 재밌는 경기만 했으면 좋겠고 올라가면 연습 열심히 더 하실 거지.
I don't have any fear of, or I don't mind if I lose against Rogue. As long as I get to the semifinals.
네.
You're gonna help me train, right?
물어보는데요?
He's asking Rogue this.
물론 도와줘야겠지만.
Yeah, of course, I guess.
일단 자기가 이긴
As a teammate.
생각하고 but, 있는 것 같아서.
But 네. saying that,
마음이 아프네요.
그렇군요. He's acting like he's already gonna get there no matter what. That hurts my feelings.
어 일단 병렬 형만 아니었으면.
Anything you want to say to Rogue?
이렇게.
As long as it's going to be against Rogue, and it's going to be a great match. It's heartbreaking that I'm going to have to defeat you tonight. So let's have some fun. All right, so that does it for our interview.
Very informative.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting when you do have two people that live together and are on a team. You know, they spend so much time theorizing about the game, practicing, supporting each other, and then when you put them together, they have to use all that against each other.
Yeah,
there's also,
yeah.
As has been said before, but it's always worth pointing out, teammate versus teammate. Mind games, we might not know. There
oh,
might
absolutely.
Be a very specific way that Maru and Rogue play the matchup when they practice, and they may be playing around that, and that's something that we don't quite get to see, but that can indicate why there will be some weird games coming up here.
Yeah.
As they're trying to
yeah.
outsmart each other. They already know what their opponent knows about them. So I don't know what to expect.
Well, yeah, I really like what you're saying about how they kind of know each other and how that goes. I think the most interesting aspect of that is the double proxy barracks rushes that Maru is always pulling out. Rogue knows about those, but Rogue also will do things like not even get a gas early on so that he's stronger against rushes like that, right? So
I will imagine we'd see a double proxy at least once.
It's Maru, so you'd expect once, twice even.
But maybe none.
Yeah.
Maybe he plays completely avoiding that. I don't
yeah.
know.
It's
you have to imagine he practiced those rushes against Rogue, right?
Of course.
So
of course.
I guess they both know the limits at which those the attacker and the defender, how much they could stretch that
well,
advantage. Or,
it, yeah. I think they've shown clearly that Maru is the best proxy double barracks Marine rusher in the world, and Rogue is the best at fighting against that out there. Right, and I think that only makes sense that they would be on the same team, the two people with those tributes, especially when it's the best Terran in the world and the best Zerg in the world, right? So that being said, I for me, that is one of the two very interesting things in this match. What happens with the double proxy barracks rushes? The other one is, what does, if we get into a pretty standard, or not standard, because there isn't a standard quite yet, but an even late game,
I was thinking
that
about that
like?
As well, is Rogue is probably the scariest late game player that there ever has been mm-hmm. in StarCraft 2. He really shows just how many things you can throw out there and try to wear down an opponent. But Maru is very good at late game.
He is.
Especially this modern Maru that we're seeing.
Yeah, and he's really shown a lot of skill in it. Of course, it's changed because the Raven is different. And you got to be careful because if you get into like a slower paced late game, that's where Rogue really shines. I kind of feel like the key for Maru winning this... This is, like, kind of going out on a limb. I probably shouldn't even say this, but, like, I almost feel like maybe the key for Maru here would be, like, going mech and hitting one of these pushes that hits the Zerg just as Vipers are coming out, and it kind of gets decided there. You know what I mean? Where it's, like, Roach, Hydra, Viper against a max mech
so
army.
It's like a window timing where he comes in and he gets in a very specific moment before Rogue has all the tools. Yeah, maybe.
Right? Because other than that, it's Rogue is strong. I don't know.
Right.
We'll see.
Map 1 is on Catalyst. This is Maru versus Rogue. A fight to get to the final four of the GSL Code S.
Jin Air Green Wings. Maru.
To what you were saying earlier, Artosis, I think this map is actually really cool to test these two guys out on.
Yes.
Because late game can be very taxing on both sides. I think it could be maybe slightly the advantage for the Terrans as Terran expand a little bit more slowly.
Jin Air Green okay. Wings, Rogue.
But you also have the fact that Rogue has the best late game ever. And
yes.
certainly this is something any good Zerg player has to ultimately deal with, is maps that can be divided in half easily
yeah.
and have... The later expansions for the Zerg are easily poked by the Terran.
It is true.
So you have to imagine that Rogue has a plan for that. And keep in mind, guys, nobody is going to make you play a super late game if you don't want to. And a lot we've seen a lot of great players play around that. They'll try to end the game right away because they don't like the situation the map puts them on.
Yeah.
That's what makes StarCraft so great, is that there are so many different ways to win. And to become a champion of the GSL CODAS, almost exclusively, you have to have a variety of different openers and styles and approaches. You got to be deceptive in some games, solid in others.
Yeah.
And so let's see how Rogue handles this.
Yeah, it's all very, very cool that these two are actually playing right now, because, you know, we always say, like, oh, this could be a finals. It is the best two players right now. And
by all current metrics, absolutely.
By any way you want to measure it, these are the best two players in the world. You see that Rogue definitely does have an edge on Maru. Maru's been one of the top Terrans forever, but just recently has been winning championships.
And let's also keep in mind, dude, wait, was this 2 years ago? Remember we had some little contest going on inside of the GSL for the people that work here? We would write down the name of who we thought would win the tournament. Do you remember this? And I wrote down Rogue because we just casted him and he looked so good, and then he did not win. He ended up getting knocked out in the round of eight.
Okay.
And, you know, and then we saw several games of Rogue where he looked good in some games and then really bumpy in others. But, you know, in the last maybe 8 months or so, Rogue has just suddenly become unstoppable.
Yeah,
that's
for sure.
It's very exciting to see him with where he's at. Look at how he's juggling these lings in
and
out.
Man, those lings are so red. Looks like he gets one. But that contest, I actually don't remember.
It was very brief. Someone handed it.
Did I win
paper.
It?
No, you did
well,
not.
Well, then I don't remember it.
With your amazing prediction abilities, somehow you did not.
I definitely don't remember it, Jaceless. It sounds to me like you made it up.
Yeah. No, this was...
I probably bet Zest.
Yeah, actually, you might have, because he was playing pretty well back then. Anyways.
Still bet him right now, Jaceless.
Yeah, you're a big Zest guy. I like this about you.
Well, I know how good he is. I actually think Rogue is going to win this. I just say Rogue for every tournament until he gets knocked out, and then I'll choose another guy. But like,
yeah, SOS was like that for a lot of tournaments with money involved. Like,
oh,
major
money. You were naming SOS every time.
Yeah, I'm like, well, just, well,
I'm like, Tasis, we're at
crazy.
WCS Montreal. He's not even here. Like, you're like, but there's a lot of money on the line.
Okay, so we have Stim on the way. This has actually been quite a passive game on both sides. Now, we don't know, you know, when exactly the pushing is going to come, or, you know, what the patterns are. For instance, with drops that we're going to see here from Maru, it looks like he's probably going to be coming out here shortly with, you know, medevacs and trying to harass. This is one of the really good builds to try to practice if you want to learn Terran versus Zerg, because you can kind of do it every time in a ladder game against a Zerg, and it's going to be fine. But
it's one of the big standards, and it has been for a little over 2 years, really.
Yeah, it's probably not going to go away for a while.
Known as the 2-on-1. He will be coming out pretty quickly with that. But
you know, one thing I want to note is that Rogue probably knows the normal areas that Maru wants to attack into.
Totally.
If they practice this a lot, because this so far has been the most orthodox standard game, TVZ. But, you know, Maru has the option to try to mix it up. He has the option to try to drop somewhere that might be abnormal, and then try to, you know, throw the Zerg off footing from there. We'll see.
Well, he's coming out right now with it. Again, the very, very standard move here. Going to go ahead and get that Overlord. Rogue sees exactly what's coming, but he already knew. He already has that Evolution Chamber getting the +1 Carapace. He's already made a ton of queens and is making a nice plume of lings right now to make sure he has enough. So this will probably just come down to Maru kind of trying to shave a little bit off here and there, maybe get a few creep tumors.
Stimpak is now done. And that's where Terran can assert himself in an actual fight. I mean, you could try to kill stuff without Stim, but obviously it's always better to have that. And that finished right when he got to where the creep is over here for Rogue. And so far, by Maru, a pretty passive play. He's not trying to overextend here. And that's definitely something you don't want to do against Rogue. Overextending against Rogue allows him to close the game very easily later on.
Yeah, if you let him get into a position where he can get to the part of the game that he likes, it's lights out. So Baneling Nest on the way, as well as that Lair. Going to be able to get into Baneling speed very, very quickly with that. 1-1 coming for Maru. Just a little bit of poking back and forth. Don't expect very much here.
Yep, keeping that pressure on. Now, Rogue's not really losing that much, other than the ability to push creep out in that central location. Now, Terran has really exploded in production. We have tanks coming out. We have Marines 5 at a time being cranked out. But again, no commitment here by Maru just yet.
Well, he's making these tanks, which I find interesting. You just brought up, right? Like, it really seems... Okay, yeah, he's going to rocket them out immediately, because that's a little bit quick for those tanks to be produced. So it seems like he just wants to push and maybe abuse those rocks a little bit, try to get those nice tank volleys. And this, of course, is before Bandling Speed is done. So Definitely some possibilities for Maru to get damage done with this.
And he can stick these tanks right down here in between the geysers.
This is very hard to hit. Fire.
Yeah, and this is a pretty secure position. There's more Marines coming up here as well. A scan to identify how many Banelings are over here. And he's actually going to have a very hard time, Rogue is, with dealing with this, even with the Banes. I mean, the tanks are, you basically can't reach them as the Zerg. You know that Maru's going to have his hockey set up so he can try to gun down the Banelings as they get in range. And now he's actually, Maru's actually isolated this expansion.
Really nice move here by Maru. You can see Rogue kind of spreading everything out. The Banelings definitely spread quite a bit. But so many Lings going down right now. The Queen's starting to have to use all their transfuses.
Yeah, well, panicked transfuses coming down there, blanketing some of those Queens. But the push continues on. A lot of these Queens now taking some damage, and the creep has been denied. The Banelink stuck in the back.
Wow.
I think that's going to be it for game one.
You're definitely right about that.
GG. Maru takes it. Right. Woo!
The constant sniping of that creep and making it all slow there, the abuse of those two tanks. Very well done. That was standard from Rogue, what he was up to. And notice where Maru never even moved from those rocks. He had this plan from the beginning. He sat on top of those rocks. If those rocks had not been there, right, if Rogue had had a chance to clear those, like, I don't know if he wanted to clear those, but if he had cleared those, then maybe he can engage down there. But as is, like, Maru cut that little area in half and just punished Rogue immediately. That was one of the most decisive Terran vs. Zergs I've ever seen against someone like Rogue.
It was very subtle, but once he got in there, you're right, he had the tanks over there, but he also was very quick to deny all the little creep tumors there.
Yeah.
Once the creep tumors were all killed off, and he started to push that third base, the creep was actually not connecting the second base and the third base. And you saw the Queens that were trying to rush forward to soak up damage, to fire some shots on that army, and to basically act as sponges so that the Banelings could get in there and do that damage. They were off creep. Everything slowed down hugely. The Banelings were stuck behind the Queens. Really good targeting there by Maru. And that's got to be scary for Rogue, because if you had covered up that Zerg player's ID and had me guess who that was, I would not have thought it was Rogue. I am used to Rogue not dying to anything early on.
Yeah.
Unless it's the craziest all in ever.
Yeah, and that wasn't really that crazy. He had two engineering bays going and stuff. He made the tanks very early, so that was kind of like, I guess, the giveaway, but Rogue completely unready for that push. And I feel like that's the first time we've seen that particular push. In fact, I'm sure in GSL, that's the first time we've seen this push on Catalyst.
Well, it's also important to note he put the two tanks in the medevac so they would not be spotted. You just assume those are more Marines or something else coming out. A lot of times with that push, we'll see with the next two medevacs that come out after the first two, there'll be more Marines, and they'll start trying to hit different locations. We've seen Maru do that. We've seen Innovation do that. But he suddenly appears with two tanks there. He sets up a position right outside where the Zerg is occupying and just abuses him. It was a really straightforward...
Yeah. He was
quite brilliant way to quickly end a game against someone like Rogue.
Yeah, he was so slow moving with his initial 2-on-1 push as well. He wasn't ever even committing it a little bit. Like, he sniped a couple tumors a couple times. He wasn't letting the medevacs take any extra damage or anything like that, because that's where Rogue starts to gain a little bit of an edge. Maybe he can push this all back. Just so well done.
The passive play worked out. I mean, had he been stimming and attacking and flying in here, then, the medevacs are more damaged, like you were saying. Mm. The Marines might be a little bit lower on HP. Instead, the moment the tank set up, he has full HP Marines, full HP with as much energy as they had. They weren't bled out that much for maybe one or two stims that came in there to get creep tumors. But a lot of energy on those medevacs, and that was just something that Rogue could not contest.
Yeah.
And we will not see that strategy again, by the way.
I don't think so.
I would not imagine you use that once in a best of five and toss it aside.
Well, that map is the only map with terrain that will allow exactly what Maru did. That was so map specific.
That's a good point. Yeah.
So, 2-on-1, we definitely could see again, but it won't look like that.
Yeah, no quick sneaky tank push. Okay, we're going to go on to map number 2 on Backwater, Maru versus Rogue.
Fight! Jin Air Green Wings, Maru. Jin Air Green Wings, Rogue.
So, you know, we keep talking about how crazy this matchup is, right? But not only does, like... Okay, so first off, if Rogue beats Maru, his ZVP is just so scary. Oh, that is great.
That is really good.
Look at that.
Damn. Ooh, that's Castor Park right there in the middle.
It's a Marauder and an Adept. It couldn't be more scary than that. But, yeah, it's like Rogue is... If Rogue wins this match, he's, like, I think, a gigantic favorite to win the tournament. But at the same time, if Maru wins this... I'm looking at the rest of that bracket, and I'm telling you that Classic is the favorite at that point. If you look at his matchups and stuff, it's like he is the best PvT, and he is one of the very best PvP. You know, I wouldn't call him the best PvP, but he's easy top three PvP. So I look at that, and I'm like, wow, that's amazing for Classic. He could pick up another GSL.
Sure,
of course,
yeah.
Things could go differently. ByuN's been playing amazingly. Maru's been playing amazingly. It's just... So much of what this GSL is likely to look like is hinged right now. The last Zerg in the round of eight, Rogue. Can he take down Maru, the defending champion?
Okay, Scout comes in now. Again, on this map, you pretty much get your third base for free. There's only one place to push by ground. Obviously, you can drop it, but this incentivizes players to try to get several expansions up early on. And you have to be pretty technical if you're going to try to actually engage somebody. You can still do it, but to engage somebody on three bases. A lot of times for the Zerg, it's the fourth base that we want to watch for, especially on a map like this. That's going to be the point of tension.
Yeah. And, you know, now that you say that, and it does look like it's going to be once again a two-on-one, but that goes again to show how crazy that last game was, that you killed Rogue on three bases, because that just doesn't happen. That's normally like all
Zergs almost never die on three bases.
Yeah,
unless
it's not that year anymore.
Yeah.
At one point, maybe, but...
You know, generally speaking, and this is kind of true for all RTSs, but whenever something dramatic has changed, a lot of games end up very short. People kill each other right away. And then players get better at defending, and it's usually the player that can keep expanding and macroing up that tends to win. That's why ByuN's win, when he was a world champion, was so shocking, because he really was just out-controlling people and out-microing them.
Yeah.
And just picking fights and winning it. Sort of, in many moments, the big game theory was not as important as how good your control was in all these little instances.
Yeah, when your control is as good as ByuN's especially.
Yeah.
Okay.
So he's just going to
like
just
run by and then run back and kill him. Like, okay, that's great.
It's not wrong.
We're gone. Yeah, the 2-on-1 going to be coming out again this time. Just going to be more harass focused. Now, Rogue not countering quite yet. We're waiting to see an evolution chamber. There it is. And some more queens. And that's how you start to counter this. Pretty much agreed upon from all the pro Zergs. You want to have a bunch of queens. You want to get plus one carapace relatively quickly for your lanes.
Yeah, you need to be beefy.
Yeah.
Well-controlled Marines can just gun down so much. And a lot of times, the Zerg hasn't actually exchanged anything. They're just pleading off units. We've had several games where people come out with the two medevacs and attack some locations. I think it was Innovation who did this more than once. But just attacked, and then picked up and moved and attacked. And then eventually he's like, oh, you don't have anything anymore. And
yeah.
And ended the game.
And that was all Marine base. Innovation and ByuN definitely had a long time where they were both kind of playing like that. And
right.
Just killing Zergs. But everyone kind of holds it now. This game, that last game, again, it's like it wasn't even Marine base. It was really those two tanks from Maru that ended up doing it and killing. But the move out is coming now. Huh. Oh, okay, never mind. Thought that was like that medevac was going somewhere weird, empty, and I'm like, what? No, it's just going to meet up with the unit. Sorry.
Nah, he's going to merge up. And so Maru's up. It looks like, at least so far, he's playing a little bit more of a normal game. Well, he's making tanks again, but let's see what happens. Okay, so here's that moment. You can see so far Maru only losing one Marine, just shaving off a few links, though. Rogue's defense is pretty good. Looks like he wanted a fake trying to go into the main, but Rogue identifies the moment that they don't appear there immediately that, in fact, he's going to come down here and push those creep tumors. Maru with really intelligent movement here on the map.
Yeah, trying to fake him out a little bit here. But Rogue, he's not overreacting really to anything. He has pretty good map vision at the moment. Sees that there's no third command center being made quite yet. Oh, look at this move. Kind of nice.
Yeah.
Forces that lift off. And actually, this moment We've seen some really top-end Zergs try this before, right? But this is a great move from Maru where he's trying to land these. If you can force the liftoff once when you have a big clutch of Lings, sometimes you can force them to run so far back to unload because the Lings are underneath those medevacs that you can get some more creep tumors down.
Yeah,
so.
It's smart. Yeah, they just can't land again. And that's sort of what we have here now. There's no ground army pushing. And especially with the number of Lings that are out, armor is just now finishing up too. Yeah, it's very hard to try to contest anything.
It looks like he wants to push again with these siege tanks. So it's a different map, and I was saying we weren't going to see this again, but we are. He doesn't have the same terrain advantage that we saw in Catalyst.
Yeah, I'm surprised he's doing this again. I truly thought that would be like something he'd whip out, but he's going to come in. 1-1 is about to finish up as well as combat shields. Yeah, there's the terrain doesn't behoove the Terran the same way it did on game one.
I would say so. You can definitely gain some value with this move, but it shouldn't be a kill move, I would say, right?
I don't think so. Let's see, though. I mean, we're kind of unpacking this right now.
Look at those spores. Like, really well placed, but he does get the Marines down.
Oh,
it's slowing the push a lot, though. Did he? Yeah, he lost the medevac, didn't he?
Yeah, he's almost about to lose a second one here as well.
Yeah. Well,
whoa, nice targeting there on that Baneling. So it looks like he's actually going to win the fight on the ground. Had that tank not hit that exact center of Baneling, yeah, it might have been a different story.
And Maru continues to try to push down some of this creep. That Baneling speed over halfway done. When that finishes, it's definitely a very crucial moment. But Maru now with just one medevac left here, he's trying to continue to get value out of these two siege tanks. I'm not sure how much there's left, though. I'm surprised he's even committing that far in against this many queens. But he does get out.
Yeah, this is quite an outpost he's got set up. You know, if he overstays this, he's going to get overwhelmed with Zerg units. But there are reinforcements coming in. And Rogue did not deny this. In fact, this is pretty ambitious, even pushing through the additional areas where there's creep spread. Now, a lot of Lings are coming around here for a counterattack. But it looks like Maru should be fine. Maru really playing a very solid game.
Yeah,
it seems to be a bit inside Rogue's head, to be honest.
Might be. I'm really surprised he tried the build again. I guess it didn't do terribly.
Yeah, I mean, he's not in bad shape. He's also continuing to pump tanks here.
He's keeping a lot of pressure on and stuff, but speed is done for Banelings. He's got 1-1, same as Maru. Talking about Rogue here. And with the Spire coming up, because there are so many siege tanks, I guess he's decided to just go ahead and grab that Spire. If he gets a decent little group of Nidalisks, then it seems like he's going to have the right type of army to deal with this. But hold on, this attack coming up. The siege tank's getting picked off quickly.
One lives. A few more volleys now onto those queens. When push comes to shove, Maru actually completely controlling Rogue here. Now, Rogue has expanded all the way to the bottom left, the only location that Terran hasn't really given any notice to.
Yeah.
And Maru backs up. Now, if you watch the supplies, Maru is beginning to slowly outgrow Rogue. And a lot of times you can have push after push where nobody's really wiping the other one out. Okay, hold up here. Another big attack coming in here. That last tank will be taken out.
And, he's picking up some medevacs here as well. Maru is going to have 2-2 shortly, and that's definitely going to help a lot. But as the mute has come out, this is where Rogue can really start to punish Maru for overextending. When you're just playing Ling Bane Queen, as long as Maru's careful and not too far in on creep, there's not a whole lot Rogue can do, but that is going to change.
Scan here as Maru is leaning in even further. Now, the combination of the Mutas, the Banelings, and the Lings, that might be enough to take this out. But again, Maru's targeting has been very strong here.
Look at this play from Maru. Like, he's playing so well. I don't think it's going to work.
Well, it's weird because it seems like none of this should be happening at all, right? And I'm not used to seeing anybody be this in Rogue's face.
Yeah, it feels like he has the most amazing game sense I've ever seen with this pressure. Like, I think this game he's known the entire time he's never going to kill Rogue. But, like, he keeps on moving in and then moving out, right? Like, he was up there, and then he's like, okay, it's time to move back now. He's getting off the creep. He's rejoining his forces and everything. He's forcing Rogue to kind of save defensive and make a bunch of units.
Okay, here comes a big attack. A lot of these Banelings trying to connect up here. The Muta's giving some cover.
Yeah, the Banelings, though, do start to connect.
And now, you know what? There's just too many Lings and Mutas. Yeah. The Marines still have to try to run away.
And the medevac's starting to get picked off here by the Mutas. That is a really large group of Mutas here, but a Thor is out.
Yeah, Thor firing down on some of these Mutalisks. It looks like there's just too many wings, though.
Wow. Oh, my God. That was a strong call by Rogue to stay there.
Yeah.
A group of Marines and a Thor shooting at his
Mutas.
Yeah,
he just knew exactly how much damage he could take there. It said, no,
that was
fine.
Impressive.
We're going for it.
Yeah, yeah.
So that pushed Maru all the way back, and now Rogue is beginning to grow at a pretty frightening rate. Maru, in some sense, said, I think, force Rogue to go into Mutaling Bane. A lot of times that's when you're really having to hold something off.
Yeah.
Mutaling Bane is probably the best at this phase of the game.
Well, especially
when it's past 10 minutes.
This tank based type of thing.
Yeah.
You're going to have a bit more mobility. You have like this one choke to defend. So I like it for a lot of reasons. In this type of game. But anyways, now that there's Thor's out, obviously the Mutas aren't going to be quite as strong, but Rogue once again getting bro. We saw this from him previously in GSL. He's starting to use more and more broed Banelings, which in StarCraft has been predicting broed Banelings to be like the nuts in StarCraft 2 since Wings of Liberty, but it seems like no one has been fast enough and smart enough and strong enough to consistently use it, but we see Rogue finally bringing that out.
Yeah, well, it's a thing where, I mean, surely for the cost of the upgrade, you're going to have a situation where you can pay for it.
Yeah.
It's going to pay for itself, excuse me. And you're right, we're starting to see this more and more. I mean, we're still unpacking StarCraft 2. That's what you have to remember here. This is not like, oh, this is exactly how you play. No, this is how we understand the game currently.
Indeed. It continues to change. And, this is a great game already.
It really is.
I'm so impressed, really, with both sides. But Rogue is starting to get pretty big. The thing is, Maru's so good at this late-game scenario. He's getting his 3-3 all finished up here.
And
he's getting even armor upgrades for his vehicles.
So Rogue continuing to grow here. He's actually taking that top center base. Maru's expanding now towards the bottom. I think most other bases are going to be a little bit tricky for him to try to take. Here's a big counterattack, though. And with the Liberators and the Thor usage here has been very intelligent. He's not just pushing him out with everything. Whoa!
Oh, no.
Oh, these mines.
Oh, that actually went better for Rogue than I thought it would. That could have been really dirty. But that is a lot of Marauders and Thors in there. Baneling's not the best against this type of unit. Oh, my God. Cost efficiency here for Maru in a lot of ways. But as the Mutas come in, this can really switch it up.
Really nice job dropping the Thor there. Just target down some of those Mutalisks. And I think Maru will actually push out again in just a little bit here. Now, pushing at that bottom left expansion is interesting because even if you deny it, you're probably not going to get anything else, you know? It's that, and then you know, where does the game go from here? I guess you could try to tear through the creep and push north, but that's the most removed expansion on the map.
It quite is, and if Maru can take that down, it's a pretty big deal. Then he can get rid of all the creep in between. Maybe that base doesn't get taken again for a long time. Oh, my God, a counterattack.
Yeah, I thought he was going to raise the wall there.
Right through the rally point. It looks like Maru is just focusing on attacking that bottom left so hard, and a lot of Lings and Banes get in. He might be able to really hurt the economy here, but in the meantime, he might be losing one of his bases.
Oh, man, we might be getting...
Almost.
Why is he not exploding? 19 kills there. However, I think just barely Maru can take out this base down
more
to the bottom. There's like a turret here and a mine. The Thor, it's kind of funny. It looks like something in the campaign.
Yeah. the Muta's coming down. He should be able to clean up the rest of this now. Thor gets dropped out to try to target. Ooh, some really good micro there on the Thor, but the match boxing of the Mutas will help it out. And, oh, man, with these medevacs being picked off, really liking this situation for Rogue now.
So, we have Hatchery taken again up here at the top. Still no breaking down of that base there for Rogue. Rogue is still hanging on. Again, Rogue with some of the best late game, probably the best late game we've ever had in StarCraft 2.
Across all races, across all players.
Yes. All timelines.
I'll defend you to the death, Tasis, on that statement.
No, because this is what's so scary about him is, okay, he hasn't been killed off. He's grown quite strong. I mean, we've had the creep constantly be contested. It's still pushed out. And now he's getting Ultralisks out here.
And you know what's really cool? Because we saw this. Was it Maru versus Solar, I believe, earlier on in GSL, where we got into the late game and Maru was just like, oh, I'll just keep making Marauders. There's no problem here. And he just stays aggressive. This is some cool late game TVZ that we are watching right now, right?
Oh, okay, he actually gets the hatch.
Oh, nice.
Now, that's not really the end of the world in some ways that expansion is sort of on the Terran side of the map, but not exactly. Like, it's a little bit more ambiguous.
One of those ones that doesn't get taken too much.
If Rogue just soaks up enough of the minerals there, I mean, that's already kind of a victory for him, right? He has easier bases he can try to take.
Yeah.
And Rogue's continuing to shut things down. I mean, he's now maxing out. There's a lot of Ultras coming up here. I don't know if Rogue wants to attack down here at the bottom. I think we're just getting a shot of this base now. I think maybe there's not a real easy way by ground to attack in anywhere on this map.
No, you're right about that. It's super hard. And if you ever attack into a planetary, if they start to get buildings in the way and stuff, and you have an ultra-spaced army, we have seen more than a few top-end Zergs throw games like that.
Yeah.
So it's pretty tricky. Like, Ultras, truthfully, are a defensive unit. Like, if you use Ultras on creep, they basically beat everything. They clean everything up in your side of the map. But once you start to get over there, that's where the cost inefficiencies come in for Ultras. So we'll see what he gets done. It's a lot of Ultras he has out right now. But Maru's preparing. He's making some Liberators, adding Ghosts. He did get Drilling Claws for his Widow Mines, and look at that huge amount of Marauders.
Yeah, that can make mincemeat out of those Ultralisks. But at this point, Rogue has actually banked up so many minerals and gas, he can actually start remaking his army pretty fast as he attacks in.
All right, Rogue expanding to the top right now, the Mirror Expo of the bottom left. I love it. Some harassment here. That Sporecrawler having a hard time. The Queen in the way.
But you can see overall, Rogue is kind of ready for this stuff. You know, you want to be getting drones ideally. So nicely done. We're seeing another drop over here. Can Maru actually contest this? Look at the targeting there. Greatly done. Getting just firing down each specific Ultralisk. You know, if you don't have enough mutas and enough overwhelming amount of stuff, Terran can stay there for a long time. It looks like in this case, he is going to be able to clean this up.
But some good harassment coming out of Maru while he switches his tech up a little bit. He's getting Cloak right now for his Ghost, adding some more Starports. Some good harass. Corruptors starting to come out, and a second Spire as well. This is very cool play for late game Zergs. I always love Zergs that go into Corruptors. Like, he's already had his mutas, but those aren't really cleaning things up quickly enough. And eventually, the Corruptors, not only can they tank more damage and pick off things like Liberators and Medivacs very well, but eventually he's going to have to kill him with something, and Broodlords is probably that choice.
Okay, but Maru with these Ghosts is starting to snipe away.
Ooh.
You notice he doesn't want to use his Banelings on that.
You're always afraid that half of them will go in and he'll lift, and you're like, no!
Okay, he's getting nukes. I'm curious to see how nukes are going to look in a matchup with these two guys. You know, there's several locations you could try to nuke at, but it doesn't seem like there's one spot that's ideal. Maybe Maru wants to abuse the fact that the map is big and vast, and therefore he can try to nuke locations that maybe Rogue can't keep track of.
Yeah. Well, I mean, again, these guys are practice partners. They live in the same house, on the same team. And so Rogue should have a lot of practice against this. By the way, a lot of tech labs onto these starports. Tasteless, is he going to make Ravens? Is he going to make BCs? Is he going to make Banshees?
I will hold my breath, Artosis.
I'm excited. Whatever
it is, I'm fine.
But he's made a lot of starports.
This is one I don't need to call to make this game interesting, Artosis.
No, certainly not. It's just, what is it? Because Ravens they just don't do the damage they used to do. Oh, it's Ravens.
I guess we did paint ourselves into a corner there.
Oh, my God. Well, the thing is, the anti-armor missile does so little damage now.
It still could be viable. Uh-oh.
Well, I guess you're right, because Maru agrees with you. And if Maru agrees with you, both Tasteless and Maru won't be wrong at the same time, okay?
The thing is that, you know, sometimes when things get nerfed, this is, like, true for any game. When things get nerfed, people just try to not use it because it's not as good. But in truth, that a lot of times things, you know, for instance, Blizzard tries to nerf a certain unit or a certain, it's like a Hearthstone card or something.
Yeah.
Well, everybody will take it out of their deck, or they'll just take it out of their build order, their unit composition, and then you find out later on, no. I mean, it was still good. It's just not as good, but it didn't make it bad.
I remember something specifically like this. There was a moment where Blue Flame upgrade for Hellions got nerfed slightly, and everyone at once stopped going mech and TBT, and I asked Major, or Special, about it. He's like, oh no, mech sucks now. And I'm like, so instead of plus 10 damage, it gets plus 5, which is still a ridiculous upgrade, and it sucks now? I'm like, I'm sorry, you guys are all stupid, okay? It's like, come on. But maybe you're right. Maybe it's like Ravens are still just the thing.
Yeah. Just maybe not as overwhelmingly powerful. Look at this. This is so smart. Oh! Okay, he gets it. You know, to lose a couple Marauders to take out these bases.
Yeah.
To point out, everybody, the bottom left base is the only thing that's not being mined from, and that, I think, lost about half its resources.
I didn't even
so
realize that.
This
right.
map is about to dry up economically. Now, even though Terran expands pretty slowly, I think Maru got additional command centers, right, to land mules. Or am I crazy? We actually haven't gotten that many shots of Maru's base.
I don't think he has. I don't actually think he does. Looking at it, like, I think he maybe has one or two extras, but not the huge amount of extras.
Either way, he has a lot of command centers. I'm just wondering who actually mines out more quickly here. Rogue still has a lot of minerals banked up. Maru's only just started that phase of the game.
All right. I guess he's going
to
go ahead and kill this.
I think he just wanted to target that down. Yep. And so, you know, was that a lot of gas? Absolutely it was. But to just take that base out of the equation, where Rogue has already grown to be huge, basically. And really, the bottom left side of the map, there hasn't been much pushing since Rogue's base was denied. So Rogue can send small guerrilla force down there.
Yeah,
I don't know if that's the right word to use, like a small guerrilla force of two Ultralisks and then like 15 Banelings.
Well, I guess at this point in the game, maybe, but it makes sense in a way as well because the Ultras are like losing value at this point. They're really strong for a bit, but now that you know, the unit sets have completely changed, the Ultras don't counter as hard.
They are quite phasic, like in nature. Like they play a role, but then you basically want to discard them.
Yeah.
In some kind of cost-efficient
way. They're like big roaches.
Yeah. Yeah. They don't have range.
Okay, I like what we're seeing here. I guess Maru has very good defense up to try to stop something like this, but this is something we haven't seen too much in late-game CBT back before the Raven nerf, is additional drops and stuff on the sides of the map we haven't seen as much as I feel like we should have, but that's what a Burrowed Ultra looks like. Tasis, take it in.
Yeah, that's right. Terran player walks over that, he just falls into that with his Marines.
Falls in and has to like 1v1 the Ultra, whatever fell in there.
That's right. Okay, great denial there on the command center. I mean, these are little victories here for Rogue.
That was a straight up kill, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was not canceled. Now, Rogue, again, he's growing economically. And even though he's maxed out, he can't make more. What's scary is after the big fight, he can make whatever the hell he wants.
Yeah.
And a lot of times what you'll do is you'll just look at exactly what the unit composition is that Terran has after the fight and just counter it. Whoa!
This is so cool. He's literally taking out missile turrets with these. Oh, here come the ghosts. Ruin all the fun. All right, get out of here, Corruptors.
But, you know, with the ghosts all over there, maybe he'll try to push this bottom left base.
It's really interesting.
I didn't notice there was a Ling there. Yeah. I was thinking to myself, I wonder if he should have just brawled the Ultralisk there, because at least it wouldn't land. But
yeah.
Oh, the perfectly spaced out Ultra. That's going to get a lot of SCVs, Artosis.
Yeah,
this actually is going to be pretty impactful.
And that could do something. Look at these air upgrades, by the way. 3-2 going to be finishing up for Rogue. He's like, that's going to be a great connection. The Corruptors come out. This is super cool play that we're seeing with these Corruptors. Look at that. Maru can't be everywhere with his whole army. That looks really funny in the air, by the way. The Ultra goes back underground.
Back to my cave. They'll never know. Uh-oh, he better stay underground, too. There's a lot of Marauders going down there.
All right, the Ultras and Lings going to clean up.
Maru, for a second, they're actually running away from that one Ultra with nothing but Marauders.
Oh, get underground!
Can't bury your head in the sand on that one, buddy. Okay, so mineral check here. The third base, pretty much mined up. I believe the fourth base is mined out. I don't know about Terran's two bottom bases. On the Zerg side, I think he still has 3 to 4 bases with a decent amount of minerals. But, you know, it's that split map problem that you can face as a Zerg player is that, well, what if Terran just mines out later than you?
I think it was definitely useful that, look at all those missiles. That's really helped out. But, okay, anti-armor missile. If you see it, that would have looked much different before. But,
Ooh, that was so good.
I guess just the fact that Rogue got some of those minerals in the bottom left makes it much less valuable.
It's kind of a weird moment. Maru's only making 3 Ravens, and he's at, like, okay, just now started another Mac run. There was a period where it was 3 Ravens making for a long time.
Yeah. Lings and Ultras still being produced here.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I thought for sure he'd like eventually go into something like Broods, but I guess he's seeing enough Vikings and Ravens and stuff that he doesn't feel like
he's good.
You know
what he might want to do? He has such a bank account. I think he can remax out, send everything down there, hit it. Remax out, send everything down there and hit it. And maybe Maru can't quite.
And then get up to 160 supply and send everything down there and hit it.
As the Raven count grows, the problems only get worse here for Zerg. It would be crazy if Maru wins this. He's up 2-0 against Rogue.
Yeah, yeah, that would be. But that bank account, it is like 4 times as many minerals, 3 times as much gas here for Rogue. So
that's right.
He's doing pretty well. You know, that map is looking scary.
It's one of these funny things where it's like the fact that it's a planetary somehow makes it almost a disadvantage. Can't get out of there. I guess with this many corruptors, it doesn't matter either. Yeah. Wow, that's a lot of auto turrets.
But without the anti-armor missiles doing insane damage, like, it's actually, the corruptors are flying in, doing damage, then turning around, and they live. You know, Normally I see those flying, then they all die, and I'm like, oh, no, that's too bad.
Rogue is in the red right now for supply. So I've lost a lot of overlords there.
Yeah,
so,
how'd that happen?
Yeah, I was wondering, I was kind of almost asking out loud, like, I don't think I saw a bunch of overlords killed back there, but somewhere that did go down. Okay, so. The upper right base, mineral rich. The rest of these bases for Rogue are not that good. It looks like what Rogue needs to do is keep Maru off of this bottom left base.
Yeah.
Now, let's also remember, normally in a split map situation, the Terran player mined all the minerals on the Terran side, the Zerg player mined all the minerals on the Zerg side. Actually, Rogue had that bottom left base, and I think he soaked up, I want to say, about half the minerals there.
Yeah, so, it may be a little bit less than half, but around there.
But the point of what I'm saying is that he will have actually soaked up more minerals overall, and that actually might allow him to tip the scale in his favor here.
So, like, equal cost efficiency does not win Maru the game. He has to be better than
Exactly.
There's something that can help, but I guess he only gets a couple.
I wonder this with nukes, because sometimes we see Terrans go a little bit too crazy with nukes, and, you know, that is a decent amount of your resources.
Yeah. Oh, he scans the Broodlords just as they're being made. 16 Broods is, like, maybe the most I've ever seen morphed at once. That is a lot. That is a lot of Broodlords. And these are 3-2 Broodlords. So that's pretty significant.
So we'll have to see it. How many snipes, how many Viking shots can come in here before they start to do the damage. And this is, you know, we use the term death ball, and I think it does sometimes get thrown around too much in StarCraft 2, but this really is a death ball.
This is
pretty much like if you try to fight this.
I've been saying for a while we should rename Death Ball. We should just call it Protoss Army.
Okay, yeah. This really is a Protoss Army moving down.
Yeah, look
here.
At this Protoss Army moving down across the map, man. It's just so scary.
Especially with this number of infestors down here. Okay, here we go.
Dude, that is a lot of Broodlords. Jeez, and they are so clumped. I wonder if there's enough anti-armor missiles to kill them all.
Okay, he's moving forward with spores here. This is the great big push. And a couple links coming in here just to interrupt reinforcements. So
yeah,
smart.
That's good stuff. Those little links are so cheap, and with 10K in the bank, you definitely want to utilize that. Look at how clumped those Broods are, though. I'm so scared. Even these low damage anti-armor missiles.
He might need to fan them out. The creep is beginning to spread in here.
He's trying to do volleys. That is so much damage. It's like 16 Broodlords attacking Yusen with +3 attack.
You can see he's getting rid of some of his drones. He wants to free up more supply. This is a very technical victory if Rogue can pull this off. It's one that Zerg players basically don't get to do. Kills one. He's trying to nuke that area. Do we have an Overseer somewhere?
Well, he's going to fungal and maybe target it. Oh, you better target it.
Get it!
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. Okay.
Oh, okay.
That was crazy.
That was a lot of anti-armor missiles, and those Broodlords are still flying around. They're still flapping.
Okay, he's starting to, now. If he pushes in here and breaks his position, I think in a matter of a minute or two, Terran loses the bottom lap. You know, if you take out this position down here, the bottom center, that's
you're,
all you need.
Yeah, you're right about that for sure.
Please?
I'm getting, like, real anxiety from this.
Yeah, this is my heart. Okay. Some ultras coming down here, and this is again interrupting the reinforcements. It's forcing the ghosts to come back. Oh my God, he's new.
These ghosts are actually like slowing him down so much, it's insane.
Yeah, but now the overseers are here. Now he's got to be careful. There are so many Vikings, and the Vikings are being used kind of like almost like turrets. like they're not trying to engage, they're trying to hold a position. Mm. But this is the position right now that Rogue can absolutely begin to assert himself in. It's going to be harder for him to retreat when he's this far out.
A Morian armor missile is coming in. And he hits a lot of them, but...
Guys, Rogue's bank account... His minerals and gas have dropped significantly. But if you look at Maru, he's spending every mineral that comes in right now. He cannot remax quite. And I think if Rogue can put a little bit more pressure, take out a few more units, any kill he gets, any structure he destroys, it's going to be hard to reconstruct that. And we're kind of... Look at this spread of Vikings.
Yeah. Well, they are really well spread, so you can't just, like, bungle them all and kill them or something.
Yeah.
And when he does eventually attack in, they can do a lot of damage.
We have Infested Terrans down here on the ground. Now, I don't know how much Infestor energy he has either. That's something else you want to keep in mind.
Yeah.
That's a resource that I don't think can replenish at the same rate. He's going to try to come in now.
Oh, my God.
Balin's coming in. Oh!
So much damage here.
So low.
The
muscles are so sick.
The Queen's coming in and casting so many spells here.
Oh my god, he broke it.
Wow.
I think Rogue just won the game with that move.
I think you're right.
He actually orchestrated that so perfectly.
And so I also feel like we are really learning that anti-armor missile is not, well, we already knew it wasn't as strong as it once was, but maybe not even really usable in mass late game. Obviously, having a couple is always useful to get rid of the armor, but the damage output of it not seeming to have that much effect against the way that Rogue is playing right now.
So it looks like Rogue should just have the closing moves here. He still has enough resources. This whole army could get nuked, and he could remake.
Well, that's how Maru can still win the game, I guess.
Yeah.
I like this, though. Look at that. He goes for a nuke, and then he goes up and tries to get those snipes off. That Ling will eventually kill all these buildings.
So he's making a lot more Banelings. He just wants to come in here and pounce once more, and that'll be game. By the way, Rogue is crazy.
Yeah, he's so good.
Maru has played so well, and Rogue just, you know,
ooh,
he was the person who could actually go all the way from A to Z. Yeah. Probably the only player in the whole world that could pull this off. Against someone like Maru, someone who actually had such a defensive spread, was just trying to outlast Zerg. And a lot of this game, guys, it goes down to Zerg taking that bottom left base. That was unorthodox.
Yeah, it was kind of cool, and don't forget, it was a different play from Maru. Like, the fact that he was really trying to push with tanks early on a map where it didn't really, it doesn't seem that strong, and then, you know, the Mutalisks were a good counter for a bit. It's been an excellent, awesome game. Now look at this army. Oh my god. That's an ST army right there.
Yeah. So he's just coming through now, and that should be it. We will see Maru tap out in a second here. And in this best of five, it's going to be tied up 1-1. GG.
Wow.
Whoa.
What a game right there. What a game. That was fantastic. I love that. I love how long Maru stayed on bio units.
Yeah.
Like, he stayed on Marine Marauder for a long time. He was doing some good stuff. He was picking off patches and stuff. The fact that Rogue went into Corruptors. Normally what you see is the Ravens will just blow up the Corruptors and you can't really utilize them, but Rogue was using them in ways we don't normally see in this matchup. He was flying around with them like he had them against a Protoss player. He was, like, puking on buildings. He was killing turrets with them.
Well, it's funny because when you have that many, first of all, the air army has to back up in a lot of situations. And the Terran army becomes a positional one. But then he just goes to these locations that are just hard for Terran to defend. They're too far out. He sprays down those buildings. Insta-kill. He's not trying to run in a bunch of Lings and Banes and Ultras, you know, and it makes it awkward if you have a Planetary because you will just lose it.
Yeah, that's it. And, I mean, even when he lifts off the other ones, if there's no anti-air there, goodbye.
Yeah. Fight!
Jin Air Green Wings, Maru.
Already going to map 3, and we don't see Proxy Barracks play yet. That was one of the big questions we were talking about early on. Acid Plant is a map he does it a lot on, too.
Jin Air Green Wings, Rogue.
I guess they know each other so well
that
that if you were to proxy barracks, it's like you're going to make a gamble, but the odds are literally just not in your favor. And then why would you do that?
Yeah.
Both these guys want to win a GSL Codex. Maru is in the position where he's trying to contend for Rogue's spot. He's trying to keep this going. I mean, this is one of these things where if he did a proxy and it was shut down, if I'm Maru, that's going to haunt me.
Yeah.
Why did I do that?
I think it also...
There were so many other ways I could have played the game.
I think it shows there... Well, we'll see as we go, because we'll at least get a game four. And as you were saying at the beginning, probably a game five. If there's just no double proxy barracks play, I think that points towards what actually happens in practice, is that Maru doesn't beat Rogue with it.
Artosis, here's what might happen, man. Huh. We might go to game five, and it's a draw. We just go to game six.
That would be...
Okay,
too
that's
epic.
How good. That's how good they are.
Well, we'd have to stop GSL. We'd have to cancel on Saturday. Zess is like, but I think I can win GSL. No, you can't.
Yeah, we're like, well, we could change the rules here.
Yeah,
we're
canceling the rest, guys. You can come in. We're gonna replay this series over and over. The classic and beyond. You can go home. They're like, can we just play? You can go home on Battle.net and play. Okay.
There's PC no cafes one, everywhere. You can play everywhere, but not here.
No one cares. Okay.
So, things to note, you know, in this series so far, Maru's done a pretty interesting quick tank push. He hides the tanks in the medevac and does sort of an ambush. He, like, tries to ambush a position. In game one, it worked out, and Rogue was completely knocked out of the game. But, you know, it was a good position to do it on. It didn't seem like it would make sense to do it on game two. And that being said, I think Maru did it probably better than anybody in the whole world could have done it. But, of course, it didn't beat Rogue.
Yeah.
And Rogue just kind of continues to grow. He's like the blob.
Yeah.
You know? Like, he just kind of, you know, and except in this case, the blob wins at the end. Humanity is gone.
If you can't kill Rogue early game, you have to have some sort of... it almost feels like I don't want to say necessarily imbalance, but, like, for instance, the Seeker missiles... Well, Seeker missile, the anti-armor missile, right?
Right, right.
Before this nerf... It did. Every Zerg in the world was kind of like, huh, how do you beat this, right? And Rogue was even saying in his interviews, because Maru was teasing that he knew how to beat it, and every Zerg's like, how? And he's like, no, really, I don't know. Right? Because he would be the guy. But it almost feels like you need that type of situation where it's like, well, no one knows how to beat this, and maybe you can beat Rogue in the late game. But if he gets there, if he has that big economy, if he has that creep spread, I mean, his decision-making, the way he moves his armies, the way he controls the late game, it's just...
You know, what's funny about it is that, and this has always been true since, like, for 20 years of StarCraft, right? Occasionally you'll get to a player who's Zerg who's so good that you can't get out of your base. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah,
where every time you leave, a swarm of Zerg units come down and crush you, and you're sitting there thinking, am I supposed to play single player? Like, what am I?
Yeah.
I know that this game is based off of me attacking you and you attacking me, but this guy has just taken over the entire map. I can't push in there. He's constantly leaning on every expansion I take. I'm just, usually the game will boil down to you just trying to take this one base outside of your base, and constantly armies are flooding down there and wiping it out and leaving. And what Rogue's doing in a lot of these games is he's just waiting. He's waiting for the Terran to take a base, and he runs in there and he smashes it, and then he just runs back. While he's getting more creep tumors, getting more overseers, spores, everything.
He's as scary as it comes. This is why he's the actual world champion. By the way, it seems like Maru is going to be going into a Hellbat push. Might feel that this is the best way to pick up a victory here, but losing four Hellions right before his armory finishes. Maybe he just felt like he could get some good damage there, but the four Hellion drop. That makes perfect sense then.
Okay, these drones.
Oh boy.
He needs to keep as many alive as possible. The splitting here from Rogue is actually really good.
It is, but that is so much damage still.
Especially this this clump up here at the top. This is 9 drones killed. This is actually enough to take the wind out of the sails here for Rogue.
Oh,
this
my
is a nightmare.
God.
It's not stopping, man. There's still...
Oh.
How is the damage being distributed perfectly evenly on each Hellion? Was each one at like 5 HP by that last volley? One of those things is supposed to die.
Yeah.
Okay, so, wow, 17 workers killed. Rogue is limping.
Yeah.
In this game.
That was really good. Like, the fact that he ran into the side with those Hellions, and it was like, it felt like an overcommittal because it seemed like a Hellbat push, but It was just a decoy. And it works out so well that now you look at the situation for Maru. This is looking good. He's going into that type of mech play that we were talking about a little bit at the beginning of the show.
Oh, my God. He's doing it again.
Yeah.
These are some big shoes to fill for these Hellions. Okay, yeah. They know what their predecessors did.
Well, even if they do as well, it's not as well, right? Because it's later on. You never live up to your father if he's a war hero. That's right. It.
There's less drones to kill. Wow.
There's less drones to kill.
Yeah. There's no way you can actually achieve that,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah. You got to do twice as well to be remembered that
That's
way.
That's right.
So, a Roach weren't on the way. This is looking so bad for Rogue right now.
Well, this is how you take down a late-game god, is you just start breaking their bones early.
Yeah.
You just start putting in these crippling blows because, you know, Rogue is one of these players. If you leave him alone for too long, he can't be stopped. And Maru's got an excellent plan here, and so far it's working.
It's just that initial drop that got all those drones, and then the follow-up drop gets drones, and now you're flying around with a bunch of Hellions still. You're forcing him into a Roach Warren. It's going to be one of these pushes that comes out, and like Rogue's composition, I don't think it's going to be the right composition, right? Because from here, okay, he's going Infestation Pit. I think what we're going to see is Swarm Host rather than going into Hive right away, because he's in a really bad spot. Like, he needs to get some serious value coming out. But the Thor drops that are going to be coming up, if he even lives through what we're watching here, are going to be insanely hard to stop.
Yeah, this is actually too much damage. Okay, barely gets a transfuse off on there. And look at this. He immediately just moves up and starts hitting the drones.
Yeah, some roaches out, so he can eventually kill these. But how many drones does he actually lose? Okay, that's going to be it for the drone loss at least.
Yeah, that could have gotten much worse.
All right, let's see if he goes into Swarm Host, or maybe he wants to go directly into Viper at this point. Let's see. It was just a moment here. But yeah, when he flies across the map with these Thor drops, right, there's no Hydras to really gun down medevacs. Maru can really dictate what's going on at this point. He's going up to four bases.
You
like,
notice
quicker than Rogue.
Yeah, I was going to say, have you guys noticed we barely looked at Terran's base? Well, because why would we when all the action is happening where Rogue is trying to defend? And I think this is a nod to no more late game here for Maru. You know what? We tried that. Yeah. Okay, and I'm not interested. And again, guys, I mean, this is what makes StarCraft so great is that you don't have to play, you know, a certain type of game. You can choose to be aggressive, and they do have to respond to that.
Well, I think the type of late game that we'll see this game, it's like, you know, just the edge of late game. You know, it's like, Maru's like, okay, now I'm at 200 supply. We're going to end it right now. You know?
Yeah.
Rogue's like, no. I need two spires getting upgrades.
Okay, so Thor drops are coming in here. Again, it's just Rogue scrambling. He's trying to put out fires.
Yes, indeed. The Thor drops, he's not even really committing too heavily, but he's making a lot of siege tanks. So this is, it seems like Maru's going for exactly that push that I was talking about earlier, where I felt like this would be the best way for Maru to end up winning this series. And the thing is, he did so much damage early game. Like, he's going to kill Rogue with this push. If Rogue does not die to this push, I'm, like, the most impressed.
Well, I think this is also why he's being really conservative with the Thors now. He doesn't want to lose a Thor or a medevac. That's how you come back into this game. So he's carting these around right over our beautiful GSL logo.
Look at that.
It's great branding for our show right
Global
here.
Global StarCraft 2 League, guys.
And, we got another one over here. See, just in case you forgot. In case you had dementia, you're like,
what
did I say?
I
said Global StarCraft 2 League right there. So, he's going to try to push up here. And Maru gracefully leaves. And this is all leading up to a climactic moment. Their supplies are basically even. But Maru has actually expanded at a pretty scary rate. In fact, Rogue's kind of, sort of supposed to have another base right now.
Yeah.
I don't know if he could. I think the Thor drops and everything else happening has stopped that. And this all really goes back to those 17 drones killed right away.
He is a little bit behind where he should be. I think he's recovered as well as you really can because he's going to have 2-2 maxed out and Vipers, which is this is what you normally see. Like, this is the fight that I was talking about when you go for mech, is generally you hit this against Vipers and you see if you can kill them. And it comes down so much to Viper play. But Rogue is trying to get a little bit on the offensive. He's trying to buy himself a little bit of time here. Doesn't even have all of his upgrades yet. Look at that. The Hydral is not upgraded. Oh, man. Very tough stuff.
So Zerg's out on the map, hoping that Terran is afraid of a Zerg counterattack, which would slow down the push. And I think it's really smart. The thing is, in positions like this, every time Zerg runs in, they just get beaten down with tank shots. That was so much damage there.
Yeah, and man, he utilizes a lot of Viper energy there on something he doesn't need to. Like, I understand the Vikings are there, and it's good to throw Parasitic Bomb on them, but the Vikings are just not super important right now. He needs to recharge those Vipers immediately, because Blinding Cloud is going to be the only chance to break this push.
Hey, he's right outside the space, and the expansion that Rogue's taking right now, I don't think that's going to last at all.
No.
By the way, I feel like those tanks should be in range, I guess. The angle's kind of odd, but I guess if he just gets vision of that.
I don't think this game is going to last at all, Tasis.
I don't think
Unless
so.
Unless Rogue has a miracle here, he should be killed. Look at those siege tanks. Oh, my God.
I think you're right. This should be the killing blow. Again, Maru just was such a brilliant opener. Hold on, here comes Rogue's Force is coming down. Some Blinding Clouds landing over here. Has he chipped off enough?
Some pretty good Blinding Clouds, but there's so many Siege Shanks in the back.
Yeah.
And he just doesn't have other tech to fight with here. He just has to make Roaches, Hydras, and Vipers. And the pressure of Maru is what has really made him go into this unit composition. So, I mean, very well played by Maru.
Even keeping these Thors in a good position where they're going to be soaking up a lot of the damage.
And he's kind of zoning back anything in the air like Vipers.
You can see he's trying Vipers. To get it. Well, there's one Ravager in here, nothing else. Yeah, that's going to be it. And now he's scanning this other new base where there was, you know, he lets that finish. He's taking this out now. It's going to be Rogue on. Well, hold on a second. Rogue took the upper right. I didn't notice that. Maybe you mentioned that.
He just took it. No, I didn't mention it.
Okay.
I saw it,
yeah. But, yeah, he's got the upper right. But Maru's already on five bases.
Yeah, this is kind of the last hurrah of Rogue right here.
He just shuffles these back a little bit further. Now, getting these Ravagers was a smart move against the tanks, but it's a bit late.
Yeah. Like, oh my god, the cost inefficiencies here for Rogue are pretty severe. I guess he will end up clearing it all. It's impressive to me that he has held on and cleared all that. The fact that he lost that many drones early on and has gotten the game into this position, because I... Just coming in my imagination was that if Maru wins the series, it's with exactly a push like this. And it wasn't even based off of killing 16, 17 drones, then 9 drones, right?
Right.
And so he did both those, did this push, and Rogue is, like, kind of holding on still.
Okay, what am I seeing now? He's actually just going to push all the way over here?
He's got 3-3.
Where's Maru's army?
Well, he died on the other side of the map.
Yeah. Nothing else left over here.
Yeah, not too much. But Maru has a lot of bases. He has a lot of factories. He's definitely not dead.
No, he's definitely not dead. I'm just surprised
I'm just super...
that Rogue is still in this game. This
yeah.
Is kinda and look at the supply. He's actually outgrowing Maru.
Yeah, but the value of the units it's like all Rogue is on like Roach Ravager for the most part. So
yeah.
Supply-wise, Ravagers are okay. But a lot of the supply is Roaches. So I still definitely give Maru the edge here. But the fact that this is a game right now, I find so impressive.
Well, it's a testament to the force that is Rogue. I mean, even Maru's probably scouting here going, oh my god, he's taking that again. I thought this game was supposed to be over. What is happening here? By the way, these Hellions are a lot bigger threat with those upgrades.
Yeah. Some Banshee speed on the way. 3 Banshees being made. That's a really great upgrade for this kind of weird game. I mean, it's something Maru normally always does, but this is a Roach Ravager army. You're flying around with 5-6 speed Banshees at this point.
Everything dies.
Jeez.
You can go in there and chip out a hatchery if you want.
Oh, yeah. You can kill their whole army if you want. Do whatever you want with it.
Choose your adventure and win the game.
Greater Spire is on the way. He's adding some Hydras, too, so that'll be some anti-Banshee. Maru's army, though. The size of Maru right now is huge. Look how many bases he has. He has 6 bases. Like, 6 mining bases.
There's actually no other base he could realistically take
for
a long
now.
Time. I mean, maybe in theory the bottom left, but generally speaking, I mean, this is Terran's got it maxed out on position here. But Maru's trying to get this killing blow in here. He wants to finish this game.
All right, going to be able to push this one down instantly. Rogue going for a counter. Yeah, I really like that Rogue is just realizing, okay, I can just never fight him for real. So he's making all of these other moves that might give him some sort of chance, right? He's like, okay, I lose a base, but you lose a base. Still behind, but still fighting.
Okay, Maru's actually trying to pick a fight up here. Is Rogue actually going to go for this?
See the greatest Biles ever. Hey, not bad for Biles, actually. And those are great blinding clouds.
Oh, even hitting some of the Banshees with the Biles.
Yeah.
But he'll have to turn around. These Banshees are just too much of a threat. It's too much damage coming out here. So he's incorporating some more Hydralisks in here.
Yeah, he doesn't have very good detection here at all. Banshee's going to go to town on this economy for a moment. Well, this detection comes up. I guess he can push it out. Look at this. More SCVs than drones right now. Still, Rogue in such a hard position. He's forced to continually make Hydras along with this as well.
And what he's doing then is he's running in here and he's just trying to take these tanks out. You can see he didn't quite have the Biles split correctly because both Biles, well, the whole set of Biles hit both tanks. And it still didn't
Ooh!
Kill them.
Ooh! Those Biles crazy. Were sick!
That was so good. Man.
You know, I feel and sound like a Rogue fanboy to keep saying this because Maru's winning this game and probably will end up killing Rogue eventually. But what Rogue is doing here is so immensely impressive.
The fact that he's still in this game and he's hanging on like this is crazy to me.
He's using, like, he's units that don't work well here.
A Terran who's basically bigger and has better units that keeps crashing in there and keeps expanding out. It's like, my God, man.
Yeah, it's insane what we're watching here. He's like fighting siege tanks with roaches over and over and over and over.
Okay. Well, you know, one thing that's on Rogue's side is probably time here, you know. It's much easier for Zerg to keep stretching out and taking the map than it is for Terran.
Yeah.
And the way this game's gone, I don't know. I can't imagine Terran losing this, but then I can't. If I had seen that initial push coming through here and the fact that both of those bases were destroyed, I just could not imagine a game where we would have been already back to this point, right?
I think that the only chance for an actual victory here from Rogue is a sharp switch into some Broodlords and pushing through.
Yeah, I like that.
That is the absolute only way to actually win, in my opinion, right? The thing is, Maru pretty much knows that's the only way that he'll ever actually die. And look at the Viking count. Like, with that many Vikings, you can't do that sharp switch. So Rogue is just kind of walking around the map. You know? He's like, okay, well, I'll do what I can and see if any situation opens itself up. But it seems like Maru is incapable of making a big enough mistake.
Okay, he's going to crash into him once again. A lot of tanks in the back here, really abusing that ground army there of Rogue. That was a lot of losses he suffered. He's already remaking 17 Roaches, getting more Ravagers.
Corvid Reactor coming up once again. I wonder, I don't think we'll really see any, but he's getting himself ready for every eventuality. Okay, throwing down some Parasitic Bombs on the Vikings. I actually really like that at this point. Ooh, those Banshees are scary too, but like, if he can somehow get Maru into a mostly anti-ground army instead of this many Vikings, maybe there's a shot.
This is going to be a rough one here for Rogue. He's going to try to come through. The spread of tanks right now, especially with these Banshees on top, so much damage. And, you know, even if you take out all these tanks, which Rogue cannot, it's going to be the Banshees that clean it up. GG.
Crazy game again. I mean, great play by Maru. That early Hellion run by, well, it wasn't run by. It was a run in on the third and then the drop in the main. From there, he dictated this game so heavily. But Rogue was, he was Bruce Lee-ing it up, man. He was water. He was working what he had and doing what he could and made the game so much closer. Almost every Zerg in the world would just die to that first push.
Yeah.
After that much damage, no, I don't think any other Zerg would even live.
Well, the theme is constant here. Rogue has got the scariest late game that there is, and he's able to survive almost anything. Maru wins when he figures out how to hinder Rogue early on, how to slow him down, how to curb that growth rate.
Yeah.
He did it in game one with a great push. He did it in game three with his great drop that came in there and slowed him down. Let's see what he tries to do here in game four. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. I want something more, no more barricades. A moment that we share, keep to ourselves. I'm as old as time, as way it used to be. I want something.
wanting more, more of you from me.
GSL Season 2, Codes, Overgrowth. GSL Season 2, Codes, Overgrowth.
아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
2018 GSL Season 2 Codex Overgrowth.
Oh, the break wasn't long enough. I had more food to eat still. I burnt too many calories casting those last three games.
Yeah, this series has been out of control. It's been so good. These two are just the best players. We're watching the best players play against each other. It's GSL Codex. I don't know, man. I'm just like,
life is good. Life is good, everybody. Right now, Maru's up in a 2-1 lead. The theme is clear.
The funny thing is, he's in a 2-1 lead. Maru's in a 2-1 lead. But I'm sitting here in my post-Zergle bliss right now. After that loss from Rogue, I'm like, damn, he's good.
I know. Wow. I'm like somehow more impressed with Rogue that game looked like that.
Yeah.
Again, if Rogue can't be stopped, the game goes on for too long. There's nothing you can do. Maru, let's see what he does now. He needs one more win, and he'll take this.
JinAir Green Wings, Maru.
Maru, some of the coolest timing attacks to dismantle Rogue.
Yeah.
To be honest, I feel like when you have these two types of players and their teammates, I would imagine Rogue is supposed to have the advantage, right? It's supposed to be harder.
JinAir Green Wings, Rogue.
For Maru to break him.
You would think. That's what I thought coming in. But Maru does lead 2-1. You know, the results are the ultimate measuring stick, right? No matter how good we think anyone is, like, that's been the story of the season with Deer. Every game is like, Deer doesn't look too good, and here he is in the round of eight having one of the hardest groups. So it's like, well, really, literally, it doesn't matter. Like, yeah, Rogue looks so good, and we keep talking about how good he looked in that game that he lost. Maru picked up the W. Here he is, match point for the rest of the match. Maybe he just wins another GSL now. He's the one that must look the best.
And what's funny about it is that the last GSL was pretty much the only thing that Rogue didn't win.
Pretty much.
So
yeah. It's been very few tournaments.
This whole tournament has been a path to redemption here for Rogue. Rogue wants to get that last little unlockable as far as StarCraft II championships go.
That's true. He's got
all the other portraits already unlocked based off of his achievements as a player.
But SOS are in that same category, actually, when you think about it. They're both, like, IM world champions, BlizzCon world champions, but neither of them have a GSL title yet. Isn't that funny? That's weird.
Must be something about the tournament. The way maybe people have more time to prepare. Maybe, both Rogue and Maru Rogue and SOS are players built of more stamina, where they might be able to win more games overall and marathon through much bigger tournaments, but... If you have just one major match, you know how much prep time that is to get ready?
It's a lot.
For one best of five, how much you could try to break down every possible thing your opponent can do?
Well, normally we talk about how that's where SOS strives, but I guess not. And as far as Rogue goes, like, we haven't seen him take it down. You know, that I feel like he really could have won that season where he barely lost to Sue in the round of eight. Remember that one? The one circling that won Sue, got Sue into second place, basically.
One Ling that blocked out, I think, three or four Baelings for... It was like 2 seconds, but I mean, long enough where, no, that's all you need.
One of the craziest... I'll never forget that moment. That's like... Just wow. Anyways, we're on East Watch. It's definitely a very big map. I would say that this map is slightly Maru-favored. I wonder if he's going to go for a mech play here again, because... Marine tank pushes can be very, very, very strong here.
Yeah, very true.
Yeah. If he goes for a bio opener, well, obviously this isn't a bio opener. He's going Hellion and some starport units, but you can still go bio behind this. But basically, if he does go into bio play, generally from Zerg, you don't really see Hydras here. It's more likely to see Mutalisk play from Rogue. Yeah, it's... The map just plays very different because of all these like high walls and like the small choke points and all that. It's hard to hold that fourth base of Zerg. Scouts that cloak.
Let's see if he keeps it. Sometimes we see this Overlord killed and then, the Terran, there it is. He cancels it. Okay, so he forks out.
And he gets a Liberator instead.
And, you know, this is, it's not unpredictable at all. I mean, it's not like, oh, Rogue's totally been duped. He's not going to know.
Yeah.
But it's not bad because it makes Rogue, it forces him to try to protect against this, right? You have to be, I mean, if you just don't get ready for Cloak Banshees after you see that and Banshees fly in there, it's like, okay, well,
yeah.
Now, why did you scout then?
Yeah. that's a good way to put it, yeah.
Just play blind. If
when I saw the cloak, that's when I knew there wouldn't be any.
Exactly. That's not really how it works. But then, you know, you go into Liberators. And you're, what he's trying to do is make Rogue spend that extra 5, 10% of his money protected against something that's not coming. And, again, this is how Maru – this is the only way to really take down Rogue, and Maru knows it, is he's got to stretch Rogue out as much as possible. Or yeah. Make Rogue stretch out, I really should say, as much as possible. Where, you know, Rogue has to be hyper-vigilant, right? He's got to be ready for everything. He knows that there's some kind of trap. There's an ambush coming. And as long as he can survive that ambush, as long as he can defend it correctly, he should be bigger, faster, stronger in the late game.
He's been doing a good job with that so far. I did like how you said it, though. He needs to stretch Rogue out as far as he can. Like, wow, we could get a sick nickname for Maru. Maru, the evil masseuse of Terran.
Oh, just barely gets all the drones out. And he's going to have to just slide over here. Three sets up immediately.
Saw that one coming.
Yeah.
Gets those queens in there immediately as well and forces
like
it back.
Liberator's going to stay alive.
I'm just going to patrol there for a moment. And Baneling speed on the way as well as 1-1. Now, I wonder what tech we're going to see here. Out of Rogue, because I was talking some big game about him not going Hyjal's Den, more likely to go Mutas. Will he do that here? Making quite a few lings at the moment. Siege Tank's, of course, coming out for Maru. Again, the bio Siege Tank push is very, very strong here. Another hatchery on the way. A macro hatchery, in fact.
That's right. He wants to power up.
I like that. Just the fact that he's saying Ling Bane, you need a lot of larva for that.
Well, also, I think he's saying, okay, you know, really, what you know has happened is Rogue has been expanding out, and occasionally Maru just comes in there and starts to beat up on Rogue. So Rogue's good. Got a slow play this one. And here we go with our initial push out. Now we have tanks being made again.
Yep. And he definitely will be utilizing those tanks for the push that's coming up now.
Now, the fact that this is going to be the third time out of four games that we've casted where Maru's done this, you have to imagine that every time that Rogue faces off against this, Rogue has learned something, right? He's adapted somehow. And so I guess the question is, has he managed to adjust enough to punish Maru for the repetition in his strategies?
Well, this game, it is a little bit slower than before, let's not forget as well, right? He opened up with a little bit of Hellions and a Viking and stuff, took that third base. So he's going to have that Spire up around before the push actually comes.
Oh, that's a good point.
Does he put a bunch of money into the Mutalisks right away? I think he will.
Because the thing is, the idea is still there, right? There are the tanks hiding inside the medevacs that don't, you know, you almost always assume those are going to be Marines. And it comes at a different time, in a different place. Now, he's still getting the 10 Mutalisks.
Wow.
Well, that was not good.
That spore. Okay, here comes the push now. Does he put the tanks right there? That's amazing.
That is beautiful.
Yep. Okay, so the Mutalisks actually can deal with this.
Yeah, Rogue has the right units
coming out. You need the Mutas to come in. See, you have to run back and forth a little bit so he doesn't kill too much. He might get that hatchery, but Rogue has to deal with this push perfectly.
Well, he's attacking without the Mutas being there, so the Banelings got shortened out.
Yeah, the Mutas are out now, though, so there's definitely a possibility. If you can get enough Lings and Banes underneath this, your Mutas can go in and kill everything at that point. Okay, here we go. The Mutas come in to get the tanks. Well, they try to get the tanks.
Try to unload out here.
Jeez Louise, that one tank. Okay, he gets it finally.
Now, the medevacs might be able to get away. They're still trying to clean up these Marines, which means Maru's still going to have a bit of muscle that he can push out with on the map.
I think that this was a strong hold overall.
Well, I think the slow play here from Rogue and tanking up and basically preempting options for Terran right when we get into, I guess, what we call mid-game here. Even though TBZ can actually go on for much longer than this. This is sort of where you are in the middle of your tech and,
okay,
you know, you've got enough of the map that you're sort of active economically.
There's no 2-2 on the way for Rogue, and he's made a lot of Lings and Banes at this point. It seems like he might go for an attack, but I don't know that he can get anything done with it. So that makes me a bit nervous on how late he's starting that 2-2. He like put so much money into units. So might get a little bit behind as far as the upgrades go, but he is going up into that hide at least. What are those Reapers doing?
Yeah, I'm actually kind of confused about the story of those Reapers.
Could have been a mistake.
Maybe it's possible when you're going this fast.
You know, if he's like macroing with all his buildings on one hotkey, maybe he didn't tap correctly, and the Reaper hotkey definitely could be the same as the Thor hotkey, something like that. I don't know.
Sure.
I'm just like kind of stretching it here, but I'm like, why do you have those two Reapers? You're not beyond.
So he's going to come in here and try to take out anything that's going to be free. And this is where the role reversal happens. Once you shut down a big Terran push like that, it's Zerg getting control of the map. And this is where Rogue is going to start getting scary. The creep is continuing to spread out in all directions. He's getting Burrow to punish any real Terran ambitions if he steps into the wrong place at the wrong time. The Mutas can shut down drops, so Maro's respecting that and staying back and playing defensively. And it looks like he wants to try to come out here with a big push, and he has to keep most of this army together. And you know what? This could be a real threat.
Yeah. Well, they're both basically maxed, and he's got sick Animuta here, and he's up 2 upgrades. That's a recipe for disaster for Rogue. So he's actually flying around harassing with the Mutas. He needs Maru to turn around and stay at home a little bit longer. He really does. Okay, I mean, this is slowing Maru a little bit, but Maru continues to push with the bulk of his army, at least.
Okay, he's now out in the middle here. He's denying this creep. I mean, the creep has actually gotten frighteningly close to the Terran base. Rogue is so on top of this, and I think Rogue might be setting up for a counterattack. But notice this, Maru keeps pulling back.
Well, look at the spread for Rogue here. He actually had his units in 3 areas. He was ready for a big flank. But even with that big flank, he needs to buy a little bit more time for these upgrades. Okay, Carapace finishing for his Mutas. The 2-2 is going to be finishing pretty quickly here. That +2 Carapace is the most important part of it. Big moments here. Like, he has done a good job slowing Maru.
Oh, wow.
Careful,
okay,
careful.
Spots that. There was a scan over there, and he still wasn't reacting right away. But Rogue is continuing to grow. It should be pointed out that this map is huge.
Yeah.
There are tons of bases that you can take. And even after you've taken all those ones, even the ones that are not easy to take, there are ones that are even further out than that. You know,
Someone described this recently on the Pylon show as like almost needlessly large with too many. It's like, why are those expansions at the bottom and top there? Like, no one ever even ends up taking all the bases on this map. It's just crazy.
Well, it's also interesting because then what does late game look like with Maru and Rogue on here? I mean, Rogue's got the best late game. I mean, as long as Rogue has bases to take, there's always hope for him.
Look, they've done a test, right? Like, the human mind can hold, like, 7 numbers in its head at once. How many bases can it hold? Like, how many bases can you take here? Like, eventually you're going to forget, oh, yeah, there was another base here. Isn't
that
crazy?
Nothing's
like
mining there. Okay, Rogue's going to try to come in.
Ooh.
A big attack. Can Maru split this up correctly?
That is so many Banelings. He's actually running into Thor's Siege Tank's Marauders.
He might as well hit the Banelings on destructible rocks. He's got so
many.
God,
he may as well just detonate them all on nothing.
And now he's second into Ultras. Maru so far pretty on top of just denying any little attacks over here. But this is kind of frustrating for Maru here. I mean, Rogue has so much of the map. It's any moment that Maru pulls out, Rogue's already got an answer. In fact, we already see a counterattack coming here at the very bottom where these depots are. And I think they actually might be able to get to the main here.
Huh.
Oh, in fact, that didn't even wall in entirely, so there you go.
Yeah. All right, well, this is a pretty darn good counterattack, and it looks like another group of units actually rolling down. Yeah, Banelings most of it. Siege Tank sitting there. By the way, there's 4 factories with add-ons here. So he's making a lot of Siege Tanks at the moment to help out.
That's right. These Mutas coming through. And just continuing to do lots of damage. He's burrowing here. This is, the upgrade there. And like you were saying, if he's making this many factory units, this is actually huge. Banes are just spilling through. Anything he can get, he'll take.
Ooh, he almost got that planetary, just barely not.
9 SCB kills.
That's significant, but he's still got 52, so I'd say the game is not over as of yet, no. But Rogue is getting so gigantic. Look at how many bases he's taken during this.
Yeah, well, look at the minerals and the gas he's banked. That's not going to go anytime soon. No. He's taking that bottom right base.
Yeah. Now, look at this. A double armory being made here once again. He did lose some of those upgrades, but he's got so many factories. He's making so many siege tanks in this late game to go with his bio. I almost feel like I'm watching StarCraft 1 right now.
Yeah, this looks like a StarCraft 1 PvP or something here.
It's just like adding in this many siege tanks to try to deal with the Link Bane Ultra. You know, it definitely, the damage output of those siege tanks will make it very difficult for this unit composition to work. It's just like if you do get into a Broodlord switch eventually, that's going to be hard to beat with the siege tank.
I get a little bit worried here. I feel like Rogue's done almost too much damage here.
Yeah.
And I don't know if Terran gets to catch up.
Maybe not.
I mean, he's targeting things down nicely. Like, you even see some of these trades aren't that cost efficient for Rogue, but do you really care when you're as loaded as Rogue is right now?
Yeah.
When you have this much money?
True, true.
If Rogue drops one of his Ultralisks into the leaves, will he actually go back and try to find it? You know? Or will he just say, that's merely one Ultralisk and I have the entire
map? It's one of many.
It's one of many.
It matters not.
That is not an important thing to me.
Right now, Rogue is, he's got so much of the map that he thinks that Ultralisks hatch in pairs of two.
That's right. Yeah, he's confused.
He's like out of touch with actually how the Zerg units are created and how much they cost.
He doesn't even know how much milk costs right now. No. He's so out of touch. He's just so rich.
Still hurting that economy of Maru. Rogue is just so big right now.
I think this actually is Rogue really reasserting himself this time around. Now, there's only 32 workers, and Maru's still almost maxed out. So there's a push that'll eventually have to happen here. But I just feel like the floor is going to open up for Maru, and he's going, his army is going to disappear.
Well, this is so Baneling focused. How many siege tanks are there actually? Because he's been producing a lot, but a lot have been picked off as well.
Yeah, especially by the mutalisks that were over that production area. I think we're only seeing two over there on the left.
I do wonder, because right, if you get like 10 siege tanks, suddenly this army is not so scary. Those Mutas still somehow doing work as well. Still getting upgrades for them also. Oh, look at that. He just restarted plus two attack for his siege tanks there. That's too bad.
Not going to leave this game until that upgrade finishes.
Yeah. Oh, okay. My God.
Now, even the angling not being that great here for Rogue, it's still going to be Maru whose supply is plummeted. The Mutas are still doing damage.
Wow.
Man, oh, man.
These Mutalists, and they showed it a little bit earlier, that only two Mutas had died. Those things have been so active this game, it's insane. Okay, it looks like he's actually just going to sack them at this point.
Yeah,
most of them.
He wants to get rid of those to get other cool stuff. So, Maru's trying to push out here. He has to make this work. It's going to be tough. More Ultras, Lings, and Banes are coming here for Rogue. And we're seeing that happen right now. I just don't even know if this is a matter of control anymore here.
Rogue is such a beast. It is so insane to me how strong he is in the late game.
Yeah.
Like, and the thing is, there were, like, moments where Maru could have gotten something done, maybe, but Rogue just, like, keeps him busy just long enough that he can get into this. His creep spread gets that much further out. He makes that many more Lings and Banes. He gets into his Ultra's tech, and now he's everywhere at once. Maru's still playing well, though. He's had some very efficient trades. It's just, there's so much Zerg.
GG. Rogue, too much! Too much! Maru tried that timing attack. He had the tanks in that kind of middle area outside the main plateau, and then he had his Marines drop there, but Rogue had already preempted it. He had Mutalisks ready. He shut it down, and from there, Maru was in timeout for most of that game. He didn't get to leave his base. He didn't get to go ahead and do any damage to any hatcheries. Rogue took so many bases, I lost count. Had just too much and overwhelmed him. And you can see, Rogue is just playing a cautious man's game.
Well, yeah, I guess it's working out at this point. It's tied up. It's 2-2. Our final map going to be Lost and Found. This series has really made me find myself, I have to say.
This has been so sick.
This is such a good series. It's insane.
These games have been so good.
I guess this is what it looks like when the best two StarCraft II players play the best match you could really ask for.
I guess that's one way to sum it up, Artosis. We're going to the last game. Lost and found, Maru versus Rogue. The winner goes on to the final four of the GSL Code S.
Jin Air Green Wings, Maru.
Hottest player on Earth right now. Game 5 against his teammate.
We've had no proxies still.
Yeah.
Just gotta point that out.
Jin Air Green Wings, Rogue.
Of course, the hottest player of the last year. World champion, Katowice champion, Super Tournament champion, I am Shanghai champion. So many big wins for him, but the GSL still eludes him.
So I guess, at least for what we've seen with these two guys, the theme of this best of five is really, can Maru stop Rogue before Rogue can no longer be stopped? Because if you get Rogue to a certain point, he is just too good at capitalizing on everything on the map, every tool that Zerg has, every weakness of his opponent.
It's like his understanding of the game is so strong. He just really knows what he's doing. He works with what he has. He's not taking bad engages unless he absolutely has to.
Yeah, unless he realizes that he's so ahead that he can actually take a really bad engage.
Which
and kill
is actually...
Because he's like, well, this is actually still going to hurt you more in the long
run. And that's one of the hardest things to do.
I'm rich and out of touch, is what he's saying.
But that is something where people throw a lot of times. They're like, well, I'm way far ahead. I can do this. And then eventually they lose. They're like, no!
Yeah.
But Rogue is like, okay, well, I can trade slightly inefficiently here because tempo-wise, I'm just going to kill you. Like, I'm going to remax and keep on hitting. And man, last Zerg left. Fittingly so.
Here comes that first Reaper in here for the scout. See if he gets any kills or any kind of little mini upsets happen with the engages there.
Oh, I think we're seeing a 2-on-1 again. I wonder if there's a little siege tank push spot.
Yeah, in fact, it looks like Shine's looking for it now.
Yeah.
Perhaps over there.
Sure.
Zerg doesn't have a third base yet, but we know that's going to happen.
That could be
but
strong.
But yeah, I think you put the tanks right there. Now, I mean, Rogue has to know, after seeing this, that he's seen what works for Maru and what doesn't.
Yeah. He's getting very fast Overlord speed this game. So that's kind of interesting. We did see him mine a bunch of gas early on. You don't normally see fast Overlord speed right now
maybe,
in this matchup
wants
especially.
Maybe he to try to fly in later and try to spot the tanks before they come out.
You're probably right. Like, but this is way slowing down his next base. Like, you know, the third base? Okay, there goes down the third. I wonder, like, he obviously is going to get in here and scout right away. He's going to see that it's a... Well, he doesn't see anything yet. But I think with the amount of Marines you see, you're kind of like, oh, I think this is a 2-1-1.
But, I mean, at this point in time, you could start out as a 2-on-1 and then transition into this other thing. I mean...
Yeah.
But I think he wants you to confirm that he knows what's coming at him. Because if he can maybe stop the position before Maru gets it, then he's lasted long enough, he has enough tools to then dismantle whatever else Maru's going to try to do.
Here's some questions. Does he know where the position is?
I think he has to
know. How do you dismantle the position as well? Like, are you trying to get over...
Maybe you want to have just enough lings? Because part of this push,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, okay.
So it's when it's not the first two medevacs. That's what makes it look normal. That's what masks the attack. It's the second two medevacs. You always have the tanks loaded in there. Because you want to kind of pop out and just set up.
Yeah.
And if you have enough lings and stuff on the ground, then they can't unload. It's that same idea. Maybe that's what you want to do.
Uh-huh. By the way, the third hatchery being quite a bit later is giving him less larva for lings and less queen production. His evolution chamber also slightly slower than you normally see against the 2-on-1. I think that the build he was doing originally, like that speed, I think he was more afraid of Hellion play or Banshee play or Hellbat play, that type of play, I think that's why he went for this, not to fight against a 2-on-1, because it seems to me that this is much less efficient against 2-on-1 than the build that he used the other games against it.
Okay, there's that Overlord Scout.
And that is a tech lab being made, but I guess it's not enough information.
Yeah, but he could probably come back in there later on. I don't think Terran's going to have enough Marines to make sure those Overlords don't get there. And if you notice, already he's making sure that these medevacs never unload.
Yeah. This is the type of move we were talking about on Backwater, actually, where you chase the medevacs down, and it seems like there's no great unload positions right now. Okay, he goes right over the ledge. That's basically how you do it to get your Marines back out. But you push them back further enough, right, that when they come back down, they have to walk down. It takes time. Then they have to scan again to get the new tumors that are where they just cleared.
Okay, Maru's back on the ground. Now, keep in mind, in game one, when he won with that push, he didn't stim in too much. He didn't lose too much medevac energy. But you can see Rogue's being really aggressive out here.
Ooh.
Anytime. Okay, now, you know, that was that taking out, even if it's four Marines, that can add up, man.
Totally.
You're going to win with this push. Pretty married to this. I mean, everything's looking like we're going to go in that direction in this game.
Yeah, he's making the siege tanks.
Yeah.
Everything looks like those siege tank pushes he was doing before.
Now, you know, if Maru loses the series, do we chalk this up to you were not dynamic enough strategically? Like, I'm glad that you won with this, but there you probably had to come up with something else. Or is he saying, look, man, this is the only way I know how to beat him?
So far, his two wins were a very cool Hellion draw, right, into that mech play. And then also the 2-on-1, like, super abusive position on Catalyst. And then he's lost the other games that just went long. I don't know. Let's see what he gets done with it. The siege tanks are here. He's setting up right in that position you said.
That same strategy. Now, notice to the right side of our screen here, there's going to be a counterattack that's going to come in. That could get these tanks here from behind.
Yeah, this is a lot of links coming in right now. He has to target those mains. The split by Rogue. He is going to slaughter this attack. Oh, that was a sick tank shot, though.
Can he keep doing this then? There's only two Banelings remaining.
And the creep is way back now.
Yeah.
There's a possibility. Going into Hydro's dead now. First time we've seen it against Bioplay.
Okay, he's beginning to push in here. Again, that last tank shot that we saw. Okay, now there's going to be less transfusions for later on. Some of those queens trying to target down the medevacs.
Oh, good transfusions. Wow, yeah. He keeps all those queens alive, but he's getting very low on that energy at this point.
He needs to get more medevacs over here. There they are now.
Oh my god, that's a lot of Marines.
No, this is a tug of war we're seeing.
Baneling speed is done, but where are the Banelings?
By the way, the hatchery is super low. I think 25% HP. And I think he might have done it. Might have just barely had enough.
Oh, I think you're right. I think Maru's going to do it.
Oh my god, he gets the base, and I think this should be the beginning of the end. All the drones go down, 24 of them.
Wow.
GG.
With dots.
GG, dot.
Oh my god.
So crazy. You know, it's funny. I thought when the tanks were killed off, for sure it ends, but if you look at it, he did get the right tank shots on the Banelings.
Yeah.
He did the exact correct move. He kept hitting those. Oh, wow. This is... this is...
He got that sick volley.
He bled out all the mana on the queens, all the energy.
Kept that creep back so much, too.
And so when the next follow-up with the Marines came, there was nothing that they could transfuse. There was nothing to help.
God. Those two are so good.
Crazy.
I just can't get over how good both those players are. That's crazy. If one of those two doesn't win BlizzCon, I don't know what's what.
So it looks like Maru may very well end up winning this season of the GSL, but
we've had so many
upsets.
Hold the phone. We got other crazy matches coming. I think if Rogue wins there, he is such a favorite. And Maru, I think you can probably say he's a favorite. He's so good. But our next match coming up is frightening good players, but we'll talk about that after the interview.
다시 한번 막았습니다. 자, 오늘 결승 같은 8강의 승자.
마루's done it again. He's stopped Rogue again. You go to the semifinals. Congratulations. He says thank you.
와, 오늘 정말 8강인데 엄청난 경기가 나왔습니다. 먼저 오늘 8강전
So this is just the quarterfinals match, but it was incredible. How do you feel?
마음 비우고 왔고 제가 병렬형을 워낙
Before the studio, I tried to empty my mind.
편하게 했는데 이겨서
I do think Rogue is one of the very best Zergs ever.
기분은 좋지 않네요.
The best, Maru. Thank you very much.
I'm just very happy that I advanced, but I also feel sorry to defeat my teammate.
정말 이 상대도 엄청난 경기력이 나왔었던 것 같아요. 상대의 경기를 어떻게 생각을 하셨나요?
What's your take on Rogue's performance tonight?
네, 제가 빌드로 이긴 것 같아요.
I think in some ways he played better than me. I got lucky on my build.
1세트와 5세트 참 이 장점인 빌드.
That's your trademark, though. That's really your play style.
모습이었는데 5세트 빌드는 즉흥적인 거였나요?
애초에
the last match.
Lost and Found랑 Catalyst는 저거 준비 생각하고 왔는데
네.
좀 잘 먹힌 것 같아요.
Catalyst 네. and on Lost and Found.
상대가 예상 못한 이런 타이밍이었다는 게 참 무서웠던 것 같아요. 항상 같이 생활을 하는 팀원인데 이거는 머릿속에서 오늘을
so
위해서
아껴주고 있다가 보여주신 house.
그런 건 아닌데
동료형한테
운전에 자신이 없어가지고
네.
생각을 좀 많이 해봤는데 이거 말고는 답이 없겠다 생각해서 네.
Well, I spent a lot of time thinking that he knows how I play really well and I just tried really hard to prepare and I tried a very specific build that I knew would be able to defeat him
완벽한 모습을 보여주시더라고요 평상시에도 이런 방식의 이런 숨막히는
Seems like Rhodes showed some incredible play
against Maru. Not just Terrence.
Yeah, one of the best Terrence.
네.
근데
you guys usually have games like that.
반감하게도 뽑길래 저도 뽑아봤는데 역시 너프된 건 안 뽑아야 되겠다.
I lose a lot to Rogue, to be honest.
네, 그렇군요. 이제 밤가는 뽑는 안 되겠다 하는 생각을 하셨는데 확실히 오늘 이 8강전 두 분의 경기였었는지 눈호강하게 되는 경기였던 것 같습니다. 자, 이렇게 판짝의 승리로 시간을 집중하게 됐습니다. 이제 상대는 바로 다음 경기로 이어지는 김도우 선수 그리고 변현우 선수가 기다리고 있는데요. 변현우 선수가 올라오는 시기를 알고 계시나요?
저는 태랑보다 토스가 나은 것 같아요.
그래요? 뭐 상대 전정 뭐 이런 거 다 필요 없고
I'd rather face Protoss and Terrence. That's interesting.
일단 불곰 버프도 있었고 현 메타에서 제가 좀 잘 맞는 것 같아서
네.
준비하면 충분히 이길 수 있을 거라 생각하고
In the current meta, I'm actually just more comfortable facing off against Protoss.
그래요? 오히려 김도우 선수가 낫다고 하시네요.
Personally, I just feel much...
그럼 냉정하게 봤을 때 이 직경기의 승자도 김도우가 될 것 같나요?
제가 현우 형 빌드를 봤는데
You think Classic's going to advance? Well, I watched Byun's builds.
네.
I'm not really sure about his builds. I don't know.
네.
I guess maybe if he plays well, he can.
아니면 2연속 우승도 가능.
He says if he doesn't play well, he won't advance.
It's a great analysis.
You'd be a caster one day.
승각이 좀 나온 것 같습니까?
Anything?
일단 제가 생각하는 원탑을 꺾기 때문에
you think,
당연히 가능할 것 같아요.
와.
Do you think he can make another GSL champion?
2연속 우승.
Says, yeah, I think so.
많은 분들이 기대를 하실 것 같네요. 자, 그럼 마지막으로 팬들에게 한 마디 들어보겠습니다.
이렇게 오랜만에 연속으로 잘하는 것 같은데 이렇게 팀원 이기고 올라온 만큼 꼭 결승 가도록 하겠습니다.
I'm really happy with my performance.
다시 한번 4강 진출
Since I managed to defeat Rogue, my teammate, I'm going to make sure to get to the finals and win this tournament. Congratulations!
네, 이렇게
What a series!
What if Maru wins all the GSLs this year and Sarah wins all the WCSs and then Rogue wins BlizzCon? I think what happens is someone at Blizzard just hits the button and the servers for StarCraft II shut off. They're like, we figured it out, okay.
It's time to end this beautiful experiment. We now know the answer. Wow, I mean, just crazy games. And the fact that Maru manages to get in there with those kind of timing attacks and take out someone like Rogue.
That was impressive,
if
man.
If you're against the best late game player in the world, that also means that they have the best defense against stuff like that, or they wouldn't get to the late game.
Indeed.
So, really cool to see Maru do that. And it's interesting to see I guess it's not just about the position of the tanks, it's what can the tanks target in that period of time, and can that cause a snowball? Because each tank volley is so impactful in a StarCraft game.
It's very true.
Anyways, we're out of time. We're going to go to a short break. When we come back, our next best of five here in the GSL Codex.